today's video, let us look at reconstruction of protein networks or protein interactomes, and there are a few interesting methods that are mostly sequence based that have gone into building these kinds of networks, such as Rosetta Stone, phylogenetic profiling and correlated mutations. So, let us look at protein networks, which are very commonly analyzed and often used for predicting different kinds of things. So, one uses protein networks to predict even essentiality, function and so on. So, what are protein networks? Again, it could mean different things, just like it could be a co-expression network or a transcriptional regulatory network or, you know, a synthetic lethality network in case of genes. Again, for proteins, it could mean just functional association or functional linkages. What does this mean? It means that the function of two proteins is somehow linked. They may basically part of the same pathway, they may compensate for one another, they might physically interact, which is a different thing. So, physical complexation is a strong kind of interaction, but it could also be just that they are functionally associated. A and B are always expressed together. A and B always find themselves in the same pathway. A and B are always in the same operon. So, maybe, you know, they are doing this some related function, right? You have a beta galactosidase and the lactose import protein in the same operon, obviously. Could mean synthetic lethality, or it could just be a projection from your gene networks. So, you just start with your gene network and project it to the protein space. So, protein interactions, proteins, you must have all, you know, read it multiple times that proteins are the workhorses in the cell, and all function, everything is mediated through proteins and particularly protein-protein interactions. So, every gene regulatory network actually at heart is a protein interaction network, or a protein, it's technically speaking a protein DNA network, but you can always think of it as a gene-gene network or as a protein-protein network. There are very interesting signaling pathways that rely on different kinds of protein interactions, right? There are a few enzymes, there will be phosphatases, kinases and a complex network of these along with small molecules, which gives you very interesting signaling cascades, which can be very tunable as well. So, the response of a signaling cascade can vary across several orders of magnitude depending upon the architecture of the signaling pathway itself. And there are many experimental methods to identify these protein interactions, and a lot of new techniques have been developed which are very high throughput and so on, like yeast to hybrid, affinity purification, mass spec of course. You can also have protein microarrays and so on. This paper is a slightly old paper now, but it's still a very good paper that gives you all the experimental methods for studying protein interactions. But in this course, we are more interested in computational methods, and there happen to be many computational methods relying on different aspects, typically based on just the gene sequences because they are abundant. So, can you infer protein interactions based on, or protein functional associations based on the gene sequences for an organism? We will see how that is done, and there is a lot of databases available, database of interacting proteins, human protein database and the string. We will look at all these in a later class, where we will try to study what are all the different types of databases which are very helpful for building, studying and analyzing these kinds of networks. So, how do you computationally predict protein-protein interactions? There are many interesting methods to predict protein-protein interactions, and these are all essentially based on genomic context or genome sequence. The first of them is what is called domain fusion or Rosetta Stone. So, you may all have heard of the Rosetta Stone, which was a popular archaeological discovery, right? So, there was this particular stone which several inscriptions which were discovered, and this is a spin on that, the name. So, the scientists basically predicted that when you have a protein that exists as two polypeptides, two separate polypeptides in some genomes, and then fused as a single polypeptide in another genome, it may be because they are likely to interact, right. So, this may be a lower organism where you find two separate proteins P2 and P3 or P5 and P4, right. But then in some other organism, perhaps a higher organism, you find them fused together in a single polypeptide. These may be two domains in some other protein, in some other cases, but they are fused together in this case.
So, this is Rosetta Stone, wherein you have two polypeptides that are present separately in many organisms that can be fused in another organism. Why? It could be that in a simple organism, one argument is that in a simple organism, these proteins are likely to be close to one another, right. So, the volume is very small, but in a larger organism, the cell volumes are so large that if you want P2 and P3 to interact, the probability becomes very low. So, if you want them to interact, might as well stick them together, right. So, the two domains are fused, so then now they are already easy to, you know, build on those interactions. The next concept involves gene neighborhood. So, what we find is that some proteins share the same neighborhood. So, if you see A and B always occur in the same neighborhood. C may or may not occur with A and B, but when A occurs, B always occurs somewhere close to it. So, they could be in the same operon or whatever. So, you find that there is proximity in across several genomes. So, remember whenever I say here genome 1, genome 2, genome 3 and so on, there are different genome sequences. So, you find a particular stretch that is common in different organisms. So, A and B occur together in organism 3, A and B occur together in organism 2, and they also occur together in organisms 1 and 4. So, based on this strength, you may say that A and B actually interact. Another very interesting concept is that of phylogenetic profiles, and this was this study actually was performed in 1999 with only 17 sequence genomes, and they were already able to find the map functions of several E. coli proteins and so on. So, what how does phylogenetic profile work? So, the consider these as different genomes, these are the genome sequences and these are particular polypeptide chains in those genome sequences. So, a profile is basically nothing but the presence or absence of a particular protein in a given sequence, right. So, you have in this case A is present in genome 1, absent in genome 2, so you put a 0, present in genome 3 you put a 1, present in genome 4 you put a 4, absent you put a 0. D on the other hand is absent, present, absent, present, absent, right. And B has the same phylogenetic profile as A. Whenever A is present, B is present, so you have a 1, whenever A is absent, B is also absent. So, maybe this A and B form a pathway that is only required together, right. I mean they are part of a pathway, so they will only function together. If A is not there, there is no rule for B as well. You could have an alternative scenario wherein you can have complementary profiles. We do not have an example of that sort here, but if you see in at least a few cases, if you look at these three genomes, the genome 1, 2 and 3, whenever A is present, D is absent, whenever D is present, A is absent, right. So, maybe they are alternate proteins that can do the same function and so on. So, you can essentially infer protein interactions or functional associations based on several genome sequences, but they would not be a synthetic lethal pair by definition because they have to exist together, right. They are functionally equivalent. So, in that sense there is a similarity to synthetic lethality, because in at least some cases we expect that if A and B are doing the same function, if you remove A, B will compensate, if you remove B will A will compensate, but if you remove A and B, the organism might die. So, that argument might be extendable here, but by definition we are saying that only A exists, but B does not exist when you are saying talking about complementary profiles.
But genome 5 is an example for that, right. So, A and D both are not there, but the organism is existing. So,
yeah. So, I am not saying that you can infer that, this is actually weak evidence, right. So, here D and A are not correlated. So, here A, B and D are present. So, I am not given an example of complementary phylogenetic profiles here, but you can essentially think about different kinds of interactions that can be there. And you may also want to see the strength of the signal, right. So, in how many of the genomes is this present? Do you want it in absolutely 100% of the genomes? You have today you have 1000 plus sequence genomes. So, do you want this the profile to be the same across 1000 bits, right. So, if you look at each of these as a bit, this is a bit vector, think 10, 10, 10. So, how many of these bits are matching? So you may just compute a threshold and say, as long as in 90% of the genomes or 80% of the genomes I find a similar profile, I might consider these proteins to interact. So phylogenetic profiling is a very powerful method to infer protein-protein functional associations.
So, but these are genomes of different organisms.
Yes, different organisms.
So there might be organisms in which that sequence does not exist. Also.
So that's possible. So that's fine, right? So then you get a zero.
No, not anything. B, A, C, D, nothing is there.
Fine. Okay. So, but you are only looking at pairwise, right? You look at two proteins A and B, and pairwise, you see that this is 10110. This is also 10110. It could have several zeros. This could be paired with another 5 zeros in the end, and you will still say that they seem to always co-occur.
So my question is, if that entire sequence is not there, so all the 4 will be 0. If you are going to pair 5 more zeros with all A, B, C, D zeros, you cannot tell that is correlated, right?
So you will have to, so if I added another 100 genomes with none of these proteins existing, so you will say that all being absent is, that wouldn't be a strong signal. So you have to do some statistical correction and so on, right? Certainly.
So it may not be lethal, but
so where does lethality come from here?
So those organisms would require these genes and the others would.
Yeah, fair enough, but what he is saying is, just having so many zeros is not good enough to infer phylogenetic, the functional associations. So, in other words, so let us say for A, the phylogenetic profile is, and for B, it is, you will say these vary only in 2 bits, so these are likely to interact, right? But now, would you still say that they will interact? Yes, I mean you have stronger evidence, but it is all negative evidence, right? So it is not very interesting that way. Whereas up till this point, you had relatively stronger evidence. Here one would say that this evidence is somewhat diluted. So you will have to actually carefully compute this, and this also need not be ones and zeros. You can have extent of similarities, right? So 0.9, what is the closest match? You typically look for something like a bidirectional best hit and so on. All these are essentially pointing towards the presence of orthologs, right? If you look up your basic evolutionary biology, so these are all trying to indicate orthologs. The last of these is quite interesting. What does this look like? It is a dendrogram, yes, from what we did in previous classes. But it is also essentially a tree of life, right? So it tells you which two sequences are related to each other and so on. So what does this look like? If each of these is a sequence, this is a cartoon representation of a multiple sequence alignment. You must have seen many of these, right? Wherein you find that this particular protein is residue is conserved, this bunch of residues is conserved. So whatever is a colored band in this picture, they all represent conserved residues, right? And what you find is there are two such proteins, right, and two such families of proteins. So 10 sequences in family 1, 10 sequences in family 2, and they are multiple aligned, right? But what you find is that whenever you have a mutation in this family, there is a mutation in this family as well, meaning to say there is a correlated mutation between these two families. So the assumption, the forecast is, whenever this protein makes a small change, this protein makes a corresponding change so that it can continue to interact. So it is like the sort of the lock and key. So whenever there is a small change in the lock, the key adapts to the lock, right, so to speak. So you have correlated mutations that happen in two conserved families, two families of proteins. So now you hypothesize that, well, these proteins are likely to interact. Maybe this is some enzyme, this is another enzyme, which is and therefore they both interact. So these are together different ways to infer edges between proteins in a protein functional association network. So you may have some evidence from domain fusion, you may have some evidence from gene neighborhood, you may have some other evidence from phylogenetic profiles, and you may also have evidence from correlated mutations or from other aspects. You could do text mining, you can have experimental data. How do we integrate all of these? That's something we look at in the next class.
So I hope you had an overview of some of the interesting concepts underlying the reconstruction of protein interactomes, basically methods such as domain fusion or Rosetta Stone, phylogenetic profiling, correlated mutations and so on. In the next video, we will move over to signaling networks, where I will give you some basic concepts and talk to you about how we go about reconstructing signaling networks.